modest proposal. A modest proposal for preventing the children of poor people from being a burthen to their parents or country, and for making them beneficial to the public, commonly referred to as a modest proposal, is a Juvenalian satirical essay written and published anonymously by Jonathan Swift in 1729. The essay suggests that the impoverished Irish might ease their economic troubles by selling their children as food for rich gentlemen and ladies. This satirical hyperbole mocked heartless attitudes towards the poor, as well as British policy toward the Irish in general. The primary target of Swift's satire was the rationalism of modern economics, and the growth of rationalistic modes of thinking in modern life at the expense of more traditional human values. In English writing, the phrase "a modest proposal" is now conventionally an allusion to this style of straight-faced satire. This essay is widely held to be one of the greatest examples of sustained irony in the history of the English language. Much of its shock value derives from the fact that the first portion of the essay describes the plight of starving beggars in Ireland, so that the reader is unprepared for the surprise of Swift's solution when he states, "A young healthy child well nursed, is, at a year old, a most delicious nourishing and wholesome food, whether stewed, roasted, baked, or boiled, and I make no doubt that it will equally serve in a fricassee, or a ragu." Swift goes to great lengths to support his argument, including a list of possible preparation styles for the children, and calculations showing the financial benefits of his suggestion. He uses methods of argument throughout his essay which lampoon the then-influential William Petty and the social engineering popular among followers of Francis Bacon. These lampoons include appealing to the authority of a very knowing American of my acquaintance in London and the famous Salmanazar, a native of the island Formosa, who had already confessed to not being from Formosa in 1706. In the tradition of Roman satire, Swift introduces the reforms he is actually suggesting by parallelepsis. George Witkowski argued that Swift's main target in A Modest Proposal was not the conditions in Ireland, but rather the can-do spirit of the times that led people to devise a number of illogical schemes that would purportedly solve social and economic ills. Swift was especially attacking projects that try to fix population and labor issues with a simple cure-all solution. A memorable example of these sorts of schemes involved the idea of running the poor through a joint stock company. In response, Swift's modest proposal was a burlesque of projects concerning the poor that were in vogue during the early 18th century. A modest proposal also targets the calculating way people perceive the poor in designing their projects. The pamphlet targets reformers who regard people as commodities. In the piece, Swift adopts the technique of a political arithmetician to show the utter ridiculousness of trying to prove any proposal with dispassionate statistics. Critics differ about Swift's intentions in using this faux mathematical philosophy. Edmund Wilson argues that statistically the logic of the modest proposal can be compared with defense of crime, arrogated to Marx, in which he argues that crime takes care of the superfluous population. Witkowski counters that Swift's satiric use of statistical analysis is an effort to enhance his satire that springs from a spirit of bitter mockery, not from the delight in calculations for their own sake. Charles K. Smith argues that Swift's rhetorical style persuades the reader to detest the speaker and pity the Irish. Swift's specific strategy is twofold, using a trap to create sympathy for the Irish and a dislike of the narrator who, in the span of one sentence, details vividly and with rhetorical emphasis the grinding poverty but feels emotion solely for members of his own class. Swift's use of gripping details of poverty and his narrator's cool approach towards them create two opposing points of view that alienate their editor, perhaps unconsciously, from a narrator who can view with melancholy detachment a subject that Swift has directed us, rhetorically, to see in a much less detached way. Swift has his proposer further degrade the Irish by using language ordinarily reserved for animals. Lewis argues that the speaker uses the vocabulary of animal husbandry to describe the Irish. Once the children have been commodified, Swift's rhetoric can easily turn people into animals, then meat, and from meat, logically, into tonnage worth a price per pound. Swift uses the proposer's serious tone to highlight the absurdity of his proposal. In making his argument, the speaker uses the conventional, textbook-approved order of argument from Swift's time, which was derived from the Latin rhetorician Quintilian. The contrast between the careful control against the almost inconceivable perversion of his scheme and the ridiculousness of the proposal create a situation in which the reader has to consider just what perverted values and assumptions would allow such a diligent, thoughtful, and conventional man to propose so perverse a plan. Scholars have speculated about which earlier works Swift may have had in mind when he wrote A Modest Proposal. James Johnson argued that A Modest Proposal was largely influenced and inspired by Tertullian's Apology, a satirical attack against early Roman persecution of Christianity. James William Johnson believes that Swift saw major similarities between the two situations. Johnson notes Swift's obvious affinity for Tertullian and the bold stylistic and structural similarities between the works A Modest Proposal and Apology. In structure, Johnson points out the same central theme, that of cannibalism and the eating of babies, as well as the same final argument, that human depravity is such that men will attempt to justify their own cruelty by accusing their victims of being lower than human. Stylistically, Swift and Tertullian share the same command of sarcasm and language. In agreement with Johnson, Donald C. Baker points out the similarity between both authors' tones and use of irony. Baker notes the uncanny way that both authors imply an ironic justification by ownership over the subject of sacrificing children, Tertullian while attacking pagan parents, and Swift while attacking the English mistreatment of the Irish poor. It has also been argued that A Modest Proposal was, at least in part, a response to the 1728 essay The Generous Projector, or A Friendly Proposal to Prevent Murder and Other Enormous Abuses, by erecting an hospital for foundlings and bastard children by Swift's rival Daniel Defoe. Bernard Mandeville's Modest Defense of Public Stews asked to introduce public and state-controlled bordellos. The 1726 paper acknowledges women's interests and, while not being a complete satirical text, has also been discussed as an inspiration for Jonathan Swift's title. Mandeville had by 1705 already become famous for the fable of the beasts and deliberations on private vices and public benefits. Locke commented, "Be it then as Sir Robert says, that anciently, it was usual for men to sell and castrate their children. Let it be, that they expose them, add to it, if you please, for this is still greater power, that they begat them for their tables to fat and eat them. If this proves the right to do so, we may, by the same argument, justify adultery, incest, and sodomy, for there are examples of these two, both ancient and modern, sins, which I suppose, had the principal aggravation from this, that they cross the main intention of nature, which will at the increase of mankind, and the continuation of the species in the highest perfection, and the distinction of families, with the security of the marriage bed, as necessary thereunto." First Treatise, Second 59. Robert Fidian's article Have You Eaten Yet? The reader in A Modest Proposal focuses on two aspects of A Modest Proposal, the voice of Swift and the voice of the proposer. Fidian stresses that a reader of the pamphlet must learn to distinguish between the satirical voice of Jonathan Swift and the apparent economic projections of the proposer. He reminds readers that there is a gap between the narrator's meaning and the text's, and that a moral political argument is being carried out by means of parody. While Swift's proposal is obviously not a serious economic proposal, George Witkowski, author of Swift's Modest Proposal, the biography of an early Georgian pamphlet, argues that to understand the piece fully it is important to understand the economics of Swift's time. Witkowski argues that not enough critics have taken the time to focus directly on the mercantilism and theories of labor in 18th-century England. If one regards the Modest Proposal simply as a criticism of condition, that all one can say is that conditions were bad and that Swift's irony brilliantly underscored this fact. At the start of a new industrial age in the 18th century, it was believed that people are the riches of the nation, and there was a general faith in an economy that paid its workers low wages because high wages meant workers would work less. Furthermore, in the mercantilist view, no child was too young to go into industry. In those times, the somewhat more humane attitudes of an earlier day had all but disappeared and the laborer had come to be regarded as a commodity. Landa composed a conducive analysis when he noted that it would have been healthier for the Irish economy to more appropriately utilize their human assets by giving the people an opportunity to become a source of wealth to the nation, or else they must turn to begging and thievery. This opportunity may have included giving the farmers more coin to work for, diversifying their professions, or even consider enslaving their people to lower coin usage and build up financial stock in Ireland. Landa wrote that Swift is maintaining that the maxim, "People are the riches of a nation," applies to Ireland only if Ireland is permitted slavery or cannibalism. Louis A. Landa presents Swift's A Modest Proposal as a critique of the popular and unjustified maxim of mercantilism in the 18th century that people are the riches of a nation. Swift presents the dire state of Ireland and shows that mere population itself, in Ireland's case, did not always mean greater wealth in economy. The uncontrolled maxim fails to take into account that a person who does not produce in an economic or political way makes a country poorer, Not richer. Swift also recognizes the implications of this fact in making mercantilist philosophy a paradox. The wealth of a country is based on the poverty of the majority of its citizens. Swift, however, Landa argues, is not merely criticizing economic maxims but also addressing the fact that England was denying Irish citizens their natural rights and dehumanizing them by viewing them as a mere commodity. Swift's writings created a backlash within the community after its publication. The work was aimed at the aristocracy, and they responded in turn. Several members of society wrote to Swift regarding the work. Lord Bathurst's letter intimated that he certainly understood the message, and interpreted it as a work of comedy. February 12, 1729-30, I did immediately propose it to Lady Bathurst, as your advice, particularly for her last boy, which was born the plumpest, finest thing, that could be seen, but she fell in a passion, and bid me send you word, that she would not follow your direction, but that she would breed him up to be a parson, and he should live upon the fat of the land, or a lawyer, and then, instead of being eat himself, he should devour others. You know women in passion never mind what they say, but, as she is a very reasonable woman, I have almost brought her over now to your opinion, and having convinced her, that as matters stood, we could not possibly maintain all the nine, she does begin to think it reasonable the youngest should raise fortunes for the eldest, and upon that foot a man may perform family duty with more courage and zeal, for, if he should happen to get twins, the selling of one might provide for the other. Or if, by any accident, while his wife lies in with one child, he should get a second upon the body of another woman, he might dispose of the fattest of the two, and that would help to breed up the other. The more I think upon this scheme, the more reasonable it appears to me, and it ought by no means to be confined to Ireland, for, in all probability, we shall, in a very little time, be altogether as poor here as you are there. I believe, indeed, we shall carry it farther, and not confine our luxury only to the eating of children, for I happened to peep the other day into a large assembly, Parliament, not far from Westminster Hall, and I found them roasting a great fat fellow, Walpole again. For my own part, I had not the least inclination to a slice of him, but, if I guessed right, four or five of the company had a devilish mind to be at him. Well, adieu, you begin now to wish I had ended, when I might have done it so conveniently. A Modest Proposal is included in many literature courses as an example of early modern Western satire. It also serves as an exceptional introduction to the concept and use of argumentative language, lending itself well to secondary and post-secondary essay courses. Outside of the realm of English studies, A Modest Proposal is included in many comparative and global literature and history courses, as well as those of numerous other disciplines in the arts, humanities, and even the social sciences. The essay's approach has been copied many times. In his book A Modest Proposal, 1984, the evangelical author Frank Schaeffer emulated Swift's work in a social conservative polemic against abortion and euthanasia, imagining a future dystopia that advocates recycling of aborted embryos, fetuses, and some disabled infants with compound intellectual, physical and physiological difficulties. Such baby doe rules cases were then a major concern of the U.S. pro-life movement of the early 1980s, which viewed selective treatment of those infants as disability discrimination. In his book A Modest Proposal for America, 2013, statistician Howard Friedman opens with a satirical reflection of the extreme drive to fiscal stability by ultra-conservatives. In the 1998 edition of A Handmaid's Tale by Margaret Atwood, there is a quote from A Modest Proposal before the introduction. A Modest Video Game Proposal is the title of an open letter sent by activist/former attorney Jack Thompson on October 10, 2005. He proposed that someone should create, manufacture, distribute, and sell a video game that would allow players to act out a scenario in which the game character kills video game developers. Hunter S. Thompson's Fear and Loathing in America, The Brutal Odyssey of an Outlaw Journalist includes a letter in which he uses Swift's approach in connection with the Vietnam War. Thompson writes a letter to a local Aspen newspaper informing them that, on Christmas Eve, he was going to use napalm to burn a number of dogs and hopefully any humanes they find. The letter protests against the burning of Vietnamese people occurring overseas. The 2012 film Butcher Boys, written by Kim Henkel, is said to be loosely based on Jonathan Swift's A Modest Proposal. The film's opening scene takes place in a restaurant named J. Swift's. On November 30, 2017, Jonathan Swift's 350th birthday, The Washington Post published a column entitled Why Alabamians Should Consider Eating Democrats' Babies, by the humorous columnist Alexandra Petrie. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.